Today, fruit trees. What I would cover, here's our topics basically. Just for our Scottsdale, Tucson, Palm Springs, Southern California folks, we do not grow citrus. Just get it out, you're not gonna have citrus. No. Not outdoors, it gets too cold. We can have some dwarfed citrus, we'll grow them in containers. We bring them indoors the end of October, and then we'll grow them as a houseplant, and we'll bring them outdoors again. So they're migrating back and forth, but citrus and avocados will die in the winter here, so they're not gonna make it. What you're looking for in a fruit tree is a tree that will bloom as late as possible in spring. So there's a lot of different types of apricots. There's a lot of them. There's probably 3 dozen varieties. We only sell 2. Tilton and Chinese apricots, because they're the last one out of all the apricots. Those are the last 2 to bloom for the season. And apricots are one of the first ones to bloom here. So they're already starting to crack and show color throughout town. Depending on your elevation, north, south, east, west exposure, we're starting to see some blooms on our apricots and plums, you know, the variety. So we're trying to curate that for you so that at least the apricots are gonna bloom before the apples, but at least we've got the varieties that bloom the latest possible out of all the apricots. Am I explaining that well enough? Okay, so that's what you wanna look for. You can grow apples, pears, cherries, apricots, nectarines, peaches, persimmons, nuts. You can grow Carpathian walnuts and almonds. We don't grow pecans. I wish we did. Actually, it will grow, but it won't fruit. Very inconsistent. Really, you got to be down that 4,000 foot level and below before we start to see true big production pecans. But almonds are huge. I mean, they just produce every year. They're a small tree, up to 25 feet. It's just pretty, and it produces a nut. So those are kind of your, in a nutshell. Those are your trees, okay? Blackberries do extremely well. Of course, they're a weed, aren't they? They just take over. I mean, small children, dogs have been lost, and blackberry brambles. Grapes do. We're surprised at how well the grapes do, from vineyard grapes to table grapes. They actually like our alkalinity. You gotta get the right varieties. If you do that, the flavor is intense. I mean, they're sweeter than you would grow in, let's say, Napa Valley, Northern California. They're a little bit smaller because of dryness, but they're sweeter. They do very, very well. We do want varieties, though, that can take our cold winters. So not every grape will grow, but there's quite a number of them that have proven themselves to grow very, very well here. Blueberries. I don't recommend starting out with blueberries. You gotta be a gardener to grow blueberries because they're so finicky. They like acidic, they like acid, acid, acid. And we don't have anything acid about our gardens. Everything is alkaline. You know, if you've owned a pool or a spa, hot tub, you know, you're always checking the pH. It's like weekly, you gotta check the pH. Otherwise, you'll take a hot tub or a swim, you come out, your skin feels like it wants, you wanna itch your skin off. You get the pH wrong, that's what happens. If the alkalinity goes up too high, that's really pronounced. And so that, you'll find that happens, and it will itch the roots off of your plants. So the plants will turn yellow, they'll lose their color, they'll look emaciated, they'll stop blooming, they'll lose their fragrance, they'll drop their flowers. There's a lot of indications of, it's not a nutrient thing, it's purely pH, and it's your water. Your water is the enemy. This is across the board, not just with fruit, but especially with fruit, but also flowering things. As the pH creeps up, it'll shed its fruits. It'll look like it got overwatered, shed its fruit, drop it. It's all because of pH. So we'll cover fertilization, maybe after pruning, I'll cover all that. How to compensate for that. Well, blueberries are really sensitive. You gotta always front load them with basically acidic food. What I find is my blueberries do best in pots, where I'm planting them in potting soil. The number one ingredient in potting soil, peat moss. Peat moss is very, very acidic, and a potting soil tends to flush all those minerals, that weight stuff that builds up in your bathtub and on the sink, that builds up in the soil too. So in containers, it tends to flush that out better, so your blueberries will actually produce better. I've had very nice blueberry bushes, but I find they do better where I can control the soil that they're in. I'm always using an acidic food. But you can grow blueberries, we sell them. But start with blackberries, then go to raspberries, then go to blueberries. No, then go to grapes, then go to blueberries. That'll be the order. With your fruit trees, I would say start with apples and pears. They're the most consistent to fruit year after year because they're the last fruit tree to bloom in spring. So they're another month out before they actually bloom. There's apricots and some plums are starting to show some color already, but apples and pears are a month out. So the order of planting for us, consistency each year of fruit, I would say apples and pears, and it'd probably be cherries and peaches, then plums. And I would say the last one is feast or famine. You either get so many apricots and nectarines you don't know what to do with them all, or you get none because the frost took them at last. This weather is not going to last. For the folks that are new here, this is not real. This is beautiful. Enjoy it for a moment because the weather will change. It will be cold again. We seem to cycle like this through spring. So that's something to watch. One reason to also have dwarfed trees. I had some here. So this is a dwarf peach. It's already in bloom. So, but dwarf, I mean true genetic dwarf. It only gets, what do you think, about chest high or so, something like that. It just stays truly, truly small. There's three types of trees. The regular fruit trees. Apples get 30 feet tall. Cherries get 30 feet tall. There's semi-dwarf trees, which is a full-size tree. It's probably 20-30% smaller than its big cousin. It's still a full tree. It could be a shade tree off a patio or something, but it's a click smaller, definitely, and easier to keep down to size and stuff. And then you have genetically dwarfed trees. We've grafted them onto very small rootstock where they only get this big, but still put the same size fruit. Just the format of the tree is the plant size. And so I've got another, this is a nectarine, genetic dwarf. So these look great in pots, just off the patio or in a flower bed, has an accent piece. That's where those things look really good. Out in the yard by themselves, like a regular fruit tree, looks out of place. It's just too small. It's not got not enough body to it. And a flower border, a bed of some sort, look really good. Especially in the middle or out to the backside, it look very good. Thank you, Grant. So that's a quick lesson on regular, semi-dwarf, genetic dwarf. Why don't we let you go over maybe pruning techniques and how you look at Grant Tibbetts again from Johnny's Tree Service. He's actually certified and a true arborist. Maybe explain what an arborist is. How do you get that certification? How do you keep it up? And how much time do you spend in trees as opposed to on the ground?
Well, an arborist is a certification from ISA, which is the International Society of Arboriculture. It's kind of the industry standard for tree care in a landscape situation. We mostly focus on individual tree care rather than, say, a plot of land or a forest situation. It has a lot to do with tree biology, soil nutrients, water management, things like that. And one of the largest topics is pruning, which we're going to cover. I probably spend 80% to 90% of my time in the trees, making cuts, everything from our dwarf fruit trees in your yard to the 100-foot-tall ponderosas or the big cottonwoods down in the parks. So I guess we'll go ahead and start with pruning. First thing, I guess would say would be right tree for right place. That's one of my biggest mantras. And that's gonna just avoid a lot of maintenance and a lot of issues to begin with. Like Ken was talking about, selecting the right, not only the right species, but the right variety as well. Ones that are going to thrive, and that's a very key word, is thrive, not just live in our climate zone. So maybe not putting a full-size apple tree right underneath your veranda or right underneath your front porch that's going to grow up into the rafters and just give you problems all the time. And that's really the beauty of the dwarf trees and the semi-dwarf trees is we're still getting production, we're still getting the good looks and the flowers and the blooms. But I think everybody buys fruit trees to get the fruit. So if we have a 30-foot tall apple tree, you're gonna need a man lift or a really big ladder, which I absolutely hate ladders, they're terrifying, to reach that fruit. So if we buy a dwarf tree, we're gonna have less maintenance, which is gonna make for a happier tree, and we're gonna be able to readily access the fruits of our labor. So that being said, right tree, right place. We'll go over a few basic pruning cuts, and all of this information is gonna be available in the email that Ken's gonna send out to you. So branch collars. This is a piece of apricot that was cut here in town. There's gonna be a swollen area on the outside of the trunk. It's gonna be a little bit different on each tree. We can kind of point some out on some green trees here. But the branch collar is cellularly different than the wood in the branch and the wood in the trunk. There's an area inside called the branch protection zone. It's this little kind of triangle-shaped area there. It used to be old practices. A lot of the old guys would say, oh, just cut straight down so it's flush with the trunk. A flush cut is a really bad thing. That tree's never gonna be able to seal over that wound, and then it opens up a pathway for different diseases, fungal infections, and decay into the hardwood of your tree. So normally we say you find your branch bark ridge, which is where the bark tissue of the branch and the trunk is pushed together. It's kind of a little bit of a seam where those tissues get pressed together. You're gonna go just on the outside of that and come down at a roughly a 30 to 35 degree angle. It's always better to leave a little bit extra than going a little bit flush. If you leave a little bit extra, you can come back later in the year and you'll see where the tree is starting to try to heal around that. The tree's gonna tell you where to cut. So always err a little bit extra than a little bit less. I'll pass these around here in just a minute. Here we have an actual branch collar. Here's our branch protection zone, right there. Our branch collar is right about there. And this would be the limb that would be coming out of the tree. So you can see how this is a completely different part of the branch and the trunk. Have any questions about the branch collar before I move on? Yes,
ma'am.
When
you make a cut like that, do you put like glue on it or anything?
No, ma'am. That also used to be a pretty widely accepted practice, the painting seal. Now that we found that through research that it actually builds a microenvironment between the paint and the wood. And that's going to hold moisture and it's going to provide almost like a petri dish, just a breeding environment for different fungal infections and different decay bacteria.
While you're on that, Grant, why don't you cover also painting the tree white, the trunk white, why they do that? Or, like, I just answered a question from a gal yesterday. She wanted tree trunk paint, that white paint on the trunk, to keep the bugs out. It doesn't do the bugs. Why do you paint the trunk white?
A lot of the times that I've seen people paint trunks is to protect from sun scald as well. A lot of the times, you know, once you stick a tree in the ground, you can't really move it. So it's gonna get a lot of UV radiation on that side of the trunks, particularly over the south and western sides. A lot of trees, especially younger trees in the early stages, are going to be very thin barked, and trees can get sunburned. You'll see on a lot of trees that aren't really managed well in nurseries when they're not getting moved around, will have a lot of dead cambium, a lot of dead bark on that prevailing side because they're not being moved. So that's probably the main reason why I see painting in landscape trees.
So a sun scald is a crack that runs from on the south side of the tree, the side that the sun hits and warms up. That sun will warm up the sap will start flowing, then that evening it will freeze, so it'll flash freeze, so now it expands, and so you get this crack going up and down almost the length of the trunk on the south side. That's called sun scald. And then it opens up the trunk for disease, just bugs, all kinds of stuff. It's not good, it won't kill the tree, but it exposes it for things that can kill the tree. So you paint the tree trunk white when they're young, mainly when they're young. And then when they're older, the bark gets thick enough, it can insulate itself from that sun. beating down the south side. Plus the canopy is larger at that point. So it can just shade itself and it's got thicker bark.
And it destroys that cambium layer like we were talking about. Cambium is responsible for flow of water and nutrients throughout the tree. So if that one side of the tree dies back, it's really gonna inhibit or it's gonna stop the flow of all that good stuff up to that part of the canopy. And that's gonna be directly relatable on that side of the tree. So that side of the trunk where you have sunscald, that part of the canopy is gonna be really thin and sparse and not be able to keep up as well as the rest of the tree.
So how do you prune?
Okay.
Make me an expert. I want to be an arborist.
See.
I'm envious.
Yeah. You got like a sheet of paper there?
Yeah, I got it. You can do this. Here, here you go. Let's pull this off. There you go. It's all yours. I did bring a couple of trees that were kind of showing maybe some examples. I had a peach here that you need to look at. Show us with a special eye. Vincent, you are in the way, my friend.
Okay, so we have, we'll say it's an apricot tree. We want to remove one of the lower limbs on it. Maybe it's coming down too far. We can't walk underneath it. It's getting in the way of other things. So I guess the first thing that we need to talk about is going to be the three-step cut. This is our branch bark ridge that I was talking about earlier, and that's where these tissues are getting pressed together. Now down here, the cells are going to be a lot stronger. They're going to be more elongated, and they're going to be tougher because it's holding up all that weight from gravity. So if we were to come in and just start cutting down, even out here, what's going to happen is the wood's going to start to split, and it's going to tear that wood all the way down the trunk, and that's not good. We don't want that. That's gonna open up, once again, a pathway for different diseases. So what we need to do is eliminate the weight on the end. So you're gonna come out first, you're gonna leave enough that you can hold on to that stub once it's removed, that you're not gonna cut your finger off. So you wanna leave yourself enough room. So we're gonna make an undercut first, typically say 25-30% through. You want to cut it just far enough where it's not going to tear, but it's also not going to come down and pinch your saw blade or whatever cutting tool you're utilizing. So that's going to be our undercut. This is called a three-step cut, and that's our first step. Second cut is going to be just outside of that, and that's called our top cut. Absolutely want it outside. If we come inside of that undercut, it's not going to do you any good. It's still going to tear down. So once we make our top cut, this larger part is gonna snap off and you're left with a stump. And then our third cut is gonna be our finishing cut, and that's gonna be outside of our branch collar. Once again, starting right outside of that branch bark ridge, this little swollen area here, and approximately a 30 to 35 degree angle off of that. Now, like I said, you can air on the side of a little bit extra to leave a little bit of stub if you're not exactly sure where that branch collar is. Sometimes it's really hard to tell. You know, each tree is going to be different as well. But like I said, air a little bit on the outside, see what happens, and you'll see the tree will actually start to heal over that, trying to wrap around that little bit of stub, and you can come in and just shave a little bit extra off. The main goal is to get that tree to grow over that pruning mode. If you see a really nice proper pruning cut, say down in the park or on some older trees, it's gonna have a little round donut right around that pruning mode. And that's that tree compartmentalizing over that cut. So that's what we wanna see, is that nice little round donut. If you do it right, further down the road, it's gonna heal over and you'll never even notice there's a pruning cut.
Grant, can you tell us how much of the foliage mass can we cut off in 1 year? And does it affect the fruit that year, or does it seem to fruit anyway?
Absolutely.
What's your experience?
You know, as a general rule, we try to say 25 to 30%. No more than 25 to 30% in a pruning season, in one growing season. Now that's gonna differ with each tree. That's just kind of a rule of thumb. You know, cottonwoods and willows, they're going to take a harder prune a lot more. And especially with fruit trees, particularly apricots and peaches, they really like a hard prune. You can whack on those guys and they're going to come back with vengeance. They seem to really respond to that very well. But the 25 to 30% rule is just kind of a rule of thumb to keep you from taking too much. If we take too much foliage in 1 year, the tree's going to kind of go into a vegetative state. It's not going to put a lot of energy into pushing out new growth. It's going to focus a lot of its resources on just healing over those wounds and storing that energy.
Could you also cover, does it affect the fruit count following year, or does it seem to fruit the same?
A tree is going to produce about the same amount of fruit each year. You know, one given tree is going to produce the same weight or mass of fruit. By doing reduction cuts and bringing that crown in, we can lessen the number of fruit, but you're going to get bigger, better fruit. Do we have any more questions about pruning ratios or the three-step cut before I move on from there?
Could you cover suckers for us? Because some trees are real prone to suckering at the roots, and some aren't, and how do you deal with that? How do you keep them from suckering?
First thing is picking a good tree. You should come talk to Ken. There's a lot of junk trees out there. There's a lot of junk trees. A good nursery is going to dispose, or a good grower is going to dispose of almost as much material as they're sending out. All these trees are made on grafts, so you're taking rootstock, you're putting a shoot on top of that, and you're binding them together. That's probably one of the most crucial stages in growing a tree. If you get a bad graft, one that's dog-legged or not very well attached, you're going to get a lot of sprouting at the bottom. That's one of the first things I look at when I see a lot of that in a landscape situation. Now, you can kind of mitigate that by cutting those sprouts. Now, with a sprout, it's a lot different. There's going to be no branch cover. It's just an epicormic sprout. It's an epicormic bud. They're almost like buds on the tips, but they're just lying dormant underneath the trunk. And those guys are just going to pop out, and they're going to continue to grow. So what we want to do with the sprouts is get aggressive with those. You want to come in flush and try to rip that little node out of there. And that can, at the very least, slow those sprouts down or maybe eliminate them from growing back. So with water sprouts, get aggressive. And that goes as well as for the interior as well. When we're talking about branch colors, we're really talking about these big scaffold branches in there. We can go on with sprouts later if we happen to get into to summer pruning. The only other cut that I really want to go over, which is pretty important in fruit trees, is going to be our reduction cut.
Quite the artist there, Grant.
Much better than last time, I believe.
I think you've lost your calling. That's it.
All right, so reduction cut. So our fruit trees, like I said, we want to be able to reach the fruit. So most of the time we want to try to make them shorter to where they're manageable. General rule in reduction cuts, the first thing you want to look for is, this would be our lateral and this is our parent stem. We want to find a lateral branch that's going to be at least 30% the size. Rule of thirds is very important in tree work, of the stem that you're removing. So what that does is it's going to allow this branch to take over dominance from the parent stem. If we were to take it from that parent stem to a little tiny branch here, this one's either just going to die back or it's just going to send a bunch of this junk epicormic sprouts out the top, and you're going to have a bigger problem than what you began with. So 30% rule. So this branch obviously is 30% the size of our parent stem that we're removing. Three-step cut. One there to remove that weight, and then we're going to come down at a 30 to 35 degree angle, just like that. Now you're retaining that branch collar. There's no branch collar up here, but that's going to, like I said, it's going to help that branch to take over dominance there.
Could you step back just a hair so the folks watching live can kind of see that drawing, looking just over your shoulder? That's perfect.
Now what we're doing by removing this is there's a lot of different growth hormones in trees. The main one we're going to be working with by doing these reduction cuts is auxin. Auxin's responsible for shoot elongation, for making those tips grow. So by removing the auxin out of these tips, we're transferring it into here. Now when you make a reduction cut, you also want to come in and reduce this part here. That's going to remove a little bit of the auxin from out of there, and that's just going to slow that branch down. So if we make a reduction cut, say on this, remove that part, this doesn't just go hairball and grow 5 feet long by the end of the summer. You know, we could bring it back down to one of these buds here, and that's just going to slow it down and keep it manageable. We have any questions about reduction cuts? Yes, sir.
Related to apricot trees, specifically in the fall, our apricot trees send out at the top of the tree shoots that are 4 to 5 feet long. And generally, those are not reproducing the next season.
No. And, you know, that's one topic we probably will cover is keeping those shoots manageable. You know, generally, we always say prune your fruit trees while they're dormant. You know, in the wintertime is one of the best times, but it's not going to hurt your tree at all to do some pruning in the middle of the summer. You know, a lot of the research now is even showing on, especially on bigger trees, to prune during the summer. It used to be widely accepted to do all your pruning in the wintertime, but it's kind of like if you're to go into surgery, or somebody was going to go into surgery, you want that person to be healthy and growing and being able to heal over. In the wintertime, they're not really doing anything, they're just kind of asleep. So by doing that pruning in the summertime, it's going to actively grow over those pruning wounds and do a better job of sealing it.
Grant, some folks are saying on the live stream, could you give us some examples? Maybe pull this tree out and show us. So this is a peach tree. Maybe show us, did you bring your pruners with you? If not, I've got mine. And then just throw them on top of this over there. I'll make sure the folks live, this has got some funky the scaffolding's there, but it's got some inside growth. Maybe you can show us, kind of tackle that. This is probably an 8 to 10 year old tree. So all of our trees, fruit trees need to be about 5 to 7 years old before they're old enough to fruit. So before that, you buy a cheaper tree, but it's a whip. So it's a younger tree. It'll be 3-4 years before it's old enough to actually, or mature enough, be an adult and actually fruit. So all of our trees here are at least 5 years old or of fruiting age. And so this one's probably around 8 to 10 years old. And so you're starting to scaffold and you've actually formed it, but still, last year's growth could be shaped some. Maybe show us that?
Absolutely. So pruning, having good tools is very important. They call us tree surgeons, they've had for a long time. You can't do surgery with a butter knife. So have good tools. First thing is, you know, basic hand snips. These are bypass shears. You can see how the blade bypasses the bottom cutting edge there. A lot of the older type ones were anvil type, so this bottom part would come further out. It'd be wider. Now, the reason we don't want to use anvil types is it just crushes that tissue. This is going to make a nice clean cut. A clean cut's going to heal better than a rough cut or a crush cut. Second would be hand saws. These are all tools that Ken carries there in the shop as well. So having a nice, good, sharp hand saw is going to make a nicer cut. You know, we don't want to be using sawzalls or hacksaws or, you know, these are designed for cutting woody tissue and they're going to do a nicer job. And then
bow saw.
Next for big wood, you know, some of your older fruit trees that have large stubs. You know, as a general rule, I like to say things like this are good for hand snips, even things up to here. After you get about to the size of your thumb, you probably want to go to a pair of loppers, which are also bypass is a very key word in that. And then anything up from there, if we're talking, you know, a couple finger width, it's probably good to use your handsaw. And then anything larger than that, either use a chainsaw or a bow saw, something that's going to be a lot more efficient.
And this is nice because it's easy for folks with arthritis to kind of get in there and just make it go. I mean, my hand kind of aches sometimes. So I'll use this when I can, but you can't get into tight spaces with this. This is like $14.99, so very inexpensive for a very good, very sharp, be careful, you can cut yourself with this blade. It goes through wood very well. For the tighter spaces, I kind of go with this. If it's bigger, I can get right into the trunk and make that 30, 35 degree cut, like Grant was saying. I can do that with this and be very surgical with it. My the loppers, why don't you hand me those loppers real quick, Grant? This, I find a lot of folks return loppers because they buy them with short handles and they can't quite get through it, so they start doing this instead of this. So this is a long handle pruner and it's a compound, so it's leveraged so that you put pressure on it and it actually accentuates it, gets you more pounds per square foot on the blade itself, so it goes through that bigger material and harder material. Oaks are just, they are a bear to get through. And so that's a good, we found this is $39.99 for a good tool. Some of you need to throw away that old tool your grandfather gave you and buy a new one. It just, these old tools, you gotta trade them out. And then this is a super hand pruner, Stay Sharp. That's made by an English company. Just if you want a good set of hand pruners, and it's a copy of Felco's, which these are like $80, $90 pruners. Boy, I gotta clean that. I've been using it. But this is like $50 for same quality. So it's not quite half price, but it's great. It's a great value for a good hand tool. I think sometimes you just need to buy a new tool. Ladies, makes a good Father's Day, good gift. So anyway.
What's the best way to clean them?
Best way to clean them? I noticed that Murphy's Oil Soap can take off the sap and stuff, and it lubricates. I also oil my tools with like WD-40, something simple. Anything you got on the shelf kind of keeps it going. And then watch your springs. Like some of your better tools, you can actually buy replacement parts. Sometimes that spring breaks or the lock breaks. Now it's a pain to use. Either replace the parts or buy another one. Sometimes the parts are more expensive. They make more money on those little springs and parts than on the whole new tool. But sometimes you can get in under it that way. So.
One thing I would probably try to steer clear of, I'm sure you've seen the pull tools with a blade on one side and a little snip with the rope on the other. It's kind of a great marketing idea to sell those two tools in one, but if you can imagine trying to use one of those in an early, densely crowned tree, it's not good. You can try to make a cut with your pull clip, but you're gonna tear up the rest of the tree with the saw blade. They are great tools to use, but I would buy separate attachments for them. With that being said, we'll go ahead.
Prune on. You're not going to make a mistake. Do whatever you think is right. It's fine. I'll sell it afterwards.
Main thing is we want to develop scaffold branches. So these nice large ones here, this one has great form already, most poetically because Ken's guys picked them out. So we want to space these limbs out to where they can grow and thrive and have room to produce foliage and fruit. So a lot of this interior growth that you can tell is already going to rub. Say like this little guy right here. That's just gonna grow up into the other stem. It can go away. Easy peasy, no branch collar on that, snip it right off. Another one of the things that we wanna be looking for are studs. You know, this was cut just a little bit on the outside, not horrible. I'm not sure if you folks in the back can see, but you can see where that dead part is and where the tree is starting to heal over it. That's why I've always said, err on the side of leaving a little bit extra, because later on you can come in and just get rid of that little bit of stub. Now the tree's gonna heal right over that. As those limbs expand diameter, you're never even gonna be able to tell. Narrow branch attachments. This one that's coming up at a really steep angle. Not only is it gonna cause issues up here in the future, but this is a really weak branch junction. If we were to let that go, as it get bigger, and especially with the weight of, say, fruit or with foliage on the end, that's gonna tear out and that's gonna rip all the way down the trunk. So not only is this in the way of our scaffold branches, but we have that weak branch attachment. We can also think about, too, our creating temporary branches. So it's still a fairly small tree, so we want to keep some foliage on there to keep feeding that trunk. So obviously this one's going to cause problems in the future. But maybe we take all of it out next year. So we can just come in, and subordinate that and slow it down and get rid of this stuff here too. And it's gonna keep on producing foliage. We have another stub here. They left a little bit extra, so that's good. Come and get rid of that. Now with peaches too, I usually try to make our trees low and wide. So these reduction cuts are pretty key. You know, here we have a real nice lateral coming out. It's growing out away towards the center of the tree. You know, we want to open up some room in the canopy to let some air through, let some light into the middle, just so it doesn't get so congested. And that's also gonna, you know, make for healthier branch structure. So I would probably come in. This is a really nice cut there. You can probably eliminate this one here in the center. And we can pick one of these that are growing out away from the center. So here's our reduction cut, just above that little branch bark ridge. Take the top out right there. Again, if you guys have a minute after the class, we can leave this here on the table. That's a really good example of a good pruning cut and how it's healing over with an orbital donut. So now we have a tree that's growing out and wide, and that's what we really want to see. We'll kind of move back down to the bottom. We have some broken limbs here. That's never going to come back. We'll get rid of that. We have one that's also going to be growing up into the canopy there. And just like I said, spacing out these scaphoid branches so the tree has some room to develop.
So Grant, I find that some folks are paranoid to make a cut. It's like cutting on their kids or something. How afraid should you be to making a mistake? If you make a mistake, what happens?
It's going to grow back. The trees grow every year. It's really hard to make a mistake on a fruit tree, to be honest with you. They're going to come back even harder the harder you prune on them. And like I said, peaches like to be hit back really hard. I don't want to come in and whack 50% out of this because then Ken might have a really hard time selling it to me.
Thank you.
But, you know, just, you know, take a step back. Removing deadwood is probably the first step you should be doing, and that's going to give you an idea of where to start. Deadwood first, thinning second, and then shaping last. You know, and like I said, kind of our main objective is to create a tree that's going to grow out and short so it's accessible for us to pick the fruit. Any questions outside of that?
Yes, ma'am. Can we go back to this gentleman's question about the live sprouts? From a terminal bud or somewhere you've pruned and it's come out?
Absolutely. So anytime we make a reduction cut, say right here, this year it's going to want to send some shoots out. Now you can either come in middle of summer, it's not going to matter. You can either take those right back down, or if you have some taller shoots that you want to retain, anytime you have a shoot, you're going to be able to see the nodes. This grew last year. So you can take this and cut it back to any of these that you like. You can cut it right here, you can cut it up here, you can cut it all the way down there. That's going to be your personal preference on how high you want it, how much you want to take out. But you can cut anywhere in here, anytime. It's not going to hurt at all.
Now for myself, I've had rows of fruit trees, and I've had orchards where I've had acres of fruit trees. Prescott Valley, the first house Lisa and I ever bought, we put fruit trees, semi-dwarf fruit trees, every 8 feet. And we just had a row, an entire back row. We made a private garden, a secret garden out of fruit trees. It could easily get too large by doing that. But what I did is I let them up to size that I wanted that looked right. I didn't let them grow any more than that. So I think we can have, when you're doing your Google search on how to prune trees, that's all agribusiness. That's for production, heavy growth. They want an extra bushel per tree. I think there's a blend that we can use ourselves in the backyard that's beauty with production. You can have both. So I'll kind of shape my trees so it fits the proportion of my yard. And then I keep it at that size. So in the summer, it will send. You'll have suckers coming up this way. I mean, some of them real long, apricots and peaches, nectarines, have real long suckers. I just go, I don't want you that tall. And then come in and cut them off. And so the book says only prune in winter. I find you can do it. It's good to keep it in shape, keep it down to size in midsummer, July, August, something like that. After you've pretty much taken the fruit off, go ahead and keep it shapely. Anyway, and some of these are just bothering me, Grant. I wanted you to cut this one off. This is just bugging me. And then this one bugs me. So when I'm pruning fruit trees, I'm like Edward Scissorhands. I'm like, there's like cuts every place. And I'm trying to get the shape, I'm trying to get the scaffolding on that thing. So when it does load up with fruit, it's got strong branches that can hold 100, 200 pounds of fruit on that tree.
That's incredible.
So,
Making the reduction cuts, like Ken was saying, when these things produce fruit, it weighs a lot. So if we have some really long extended branches that are coming out, whenever we have the fruit on that, it's going to want to break those branches, it's going to want to bring them down to the ground, then you got your peaches sitting in the dirt, and we don't want that. Once again, coming back to auxin, by removing those tips, it's going to slow that branch down. Sugars are localized, so all of these little leaves that this tree is going to produce, it's going to feed this branch, and it's going to feed this area of the trunk. It's not going to feed the rest of the tree. So by reducing that, we're going to slow the branch down, so it's not going to be as long, and it's going to create a thicker diameter on the limb. It's kind of like having a 5-gallon bucket of water or a 5-gallon bucket of peaches. So if I have a 5-gallon bucket of peaches and I try to hold it out like that, it's going to be a lot of work. It's going to be really hard to hold for an extended amount of time. We bring it in, it's going to be a lot easier to hold, and it's going to be a lot stronger. You're not going to have these big catastrophic tear outs on your tree. So bringing those long limbs in, keeping them reduced, is a great thing to do. And as far as reducing those sprouts during the summer, another thing to think about too is cutting them while they're small. You're making a way smaller wound on the top of your tree. If you wait till, you know, the end of the year or the winter when they've been growing all year round, some of those sprouts can get pretty substantial, and you're just making a way larger cut. So I think it's a really great idea to keep those sprouts in check.
I would also suggest, just while we're on fruit and weight, I've seen a lot of mistakes made where when you're planting a fruit tree, stake it. For the love of gardening, stake your trees. We get a prevailing southwest wind that comes in, and it's nonstop, April through March, first part of June. It just blows constantly. So as that tree is waking up and growing, it starts to grow to the northeast. Then it loads up with fruit, and I've seen more trees fall out of the ground. They just wait, all that weight is on this leaning tree, and it just falls over. And so you want to make sure, as that tree is rooting, keep it as straight as possible. Go against the wind. We're trying to prevent that leaning mode up from that southwest spring wind. So that's, as you're planting new trees, really watch that. And usually what we'll do is we'll put a stake. If we were coming out to plant for you, we'd put a stake here, and a stake here just outside the root ball. We tie once to the trunk. We want it to move. We want the wind to blow it around so it creates strength. We don't want it to start leaning to the northeast. And you'll see that as you go through your neighborhood, now that you know that little tip, you'll see fruit trees that weren't staked when they're first put in the ground, and they're all leaning to the northeast in the same direction because of the wind. So watch that one. That's unique to mountain. It's mountain gardens is what causes that. Why don't you show this, because it was another pear example while I got the experts. I've got a that was a peach. Pears grow like that. And this just had some examples of broken. It's growing to the inside. I mean, it's a beautiful tree. It's just, it could open it up a little bit.
So kind of the same deal. We're looking to open up our canopies. So both of these growing into the middle. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I wonder how tall should your stake be when you put it
in? Doesn't matter. Just proportionate. Usually right like here, kind of just above a couple branches.
So
right there would be good.
3 feet or so?
But if you had a tie here, that's fine. So I just don't want it to blow where that tie tape or strap or wire is girdling or cutting. So generally we'll try to go somewhere in here for the stake. Okay, just once is fine. If it's a really big tree, like I've got some 15, 20 foot maples up front. There we put two stakes in the ground, and we might tie it off twice. We want it to move, we just don't want it to start leaning and growing in that northeast direction. Does that make sense? Where to stake? Good.
Okay. So these two growing into the middle, you just hit that right there.
No!
That's going to make that.
That's fine.
We have a broken limb on the outside here. That's not doing anybody any good. Just a pin there. Here we have, you know, another stub, yeah, which is good. You know, we want to see a little bit extra, then a little bit less. Here we got this one going into the middle. It's not doing anybody any good either.
Good.
Got some more stubs here.
You're hired.
Probably open this up in here. Give this some a little bit of space to develop.
Good. You do want to open the middle of a fruit tree up so it can get air and sunlight. It prevents insects and it prevents disease or leaf spot. There's curls, dollar spot, there's all kinds of leaf diseases if that tree is packed and it can't breathe. So we're trying to open that up so that the wind and the sun can come in and it makes the fruit sweeter, that kind of stuff. So good, that's beautiful. Well done, apricot. No, dwarf nectarine. You can see it's growing a little bit crooked in the bucket. You see it's kind of leaning that way, but it's a beautiful plant. When you plant it in your yard, just plant it straight. Really easy to recover. Go for shape of the tree, the trunk caliper, how the grafts look, the actual structure. Don't worry that it's crooked in the bucket, because you can plant that straight out in the yard. Spend your money on the trees. A good quality tree. You want to really get a nice tree. You could cut your money back on shrubs. Red tip photinia. Why someone would buy a 15-gallon red tip photinia and you can get a 1 gallon or 5 gallon, cut your money back on this so that you free up some landscape dollars to put it into trees. Trees are where it's really at, and you can never turn an ugly tree beautiful. It's just not, once it's dog-legged, it's always, once it's starting to overgrow, the trees are where the quality really shines, more so than shrubs. I mean, money's no object, I have all sizes for everyone, but if you're trying to make your budget stretch, I'm trying to help someone put a new landscape in, I'll tell them, let's go cheaper here so we free up some money to go nicer here. So it really makes a difference in the long run of how your landscape matures and fills in. The best time to plant a tree? 10 years ago. The next best time? Today. I think Abraham Lincoln or someone said that. Thanks for coming.